I would like to start with seeing some hands. For whom is this the first conference? Okay, and other people who did it two times? And three times? And the real old farts who are there for the fourth time? Cool. Okay, for the people who are new here, I mean, this is the Waag Society. The building is the 15th century part of the old city wall. This building is famous for two important historical events. The first is right at this spot in the 17th century, Rembrandt painted his famous anatomical lesson. And the second historical event is in 2002, right here, Blender became open source, exactly 3 years ago. I will give a short presentation about what we've been doing in the past years. So it's an overview of last year, what the plans are for next year, and a little bit about the conference schedule. So the first thing which matters, of course, is Blender releases. We only did three in the last year. I tried to count, I probably missed one, but it's only three. And one release actually was a bug fix release. But if you look at what we've been doing since the last conference, this is an enormous list of features, and that doesn't even include what we are doing at this very moment, which is moving to Blender 2.4 to 40, which will have the animation system makeover, a brand new IK module, a dependency graph system, which makes sure that everything you do is real-time and solved in the correct way without lagging. The Bodifier system, I think people already tried that. It's a very important thing to have mesh drawing, mesh modeling drawing, connected to modifiers. So you can have automatic mirroring while editing even. If you have deform meshes in edit mode, you can see that as well. And you can stack all of that. We've got new subdivision tools in the mesh editing. We've even seen a game engine revival. There will be on this conference a talk about it as well. But the original coder came back and he added new physics in the game engine. We've got fluid simulation, really spectacular. First, this will be shown in the next talk. Python textures, hair strands, text object improvements, particle guides, we're finalizing the user interface project. So we couldn't release this before this conference. There was just too much to do. So the work is still going on, but we hope to have in November the final 2.4 release. A little bit about the Blender Foundation. In the past year, we've been really doing well. Financially, we are independent, we are healthy. For example, eShop and publishing made us a revenue of 112,000 euros, which is still like 130,000 American dollars. We've also received subsidies, part from the European Union and part from the Dutch government, which is about 50,000 euros. And that enables the foundation to have. That's me. I can work for full time on Blender related issues. We also have a couple of part timers. For example, the eShop is being handled. Business. We have a system administrator for the website and webmaster services. Recently, we've also added the development support, which is a part of the Orange Studio. Other activities the foundation is doing, I'd like to mention the Universe Consortium. This is the European Union consortium consisting of the Helsinki Technical University, the Stockholm Technical University, the Swedish Interactive Institute, the Fraunhofer Institute in Germany, and the Blender Foundation. And together we are validating and testing the first protocol. Participating in this consortium also adds a lot to our revenues. So this is also a business side of the foundation. And then, last year we did a SIGGRAPH presentation again. This, for people who know, SIGGRAPH is the biggest computer graphics conference in the world. We managed to get a theater room for a whole day to do presentations and demos. I've also been on an open source panel discussion, so I've got my first speaker ribbon in SIGGRAPH. That's where all the important guys walk with. I've met with very interesting people from the movie industry. We had dinner together in the evening before the panel, and I've learned a lot from it. And this is something we're going to see back in the Orange Project as well. We were forced to do a website refresh. I mean, this was scheduled, but not planned, really. For some reason, people have been finding the Blender website attractive to hack or to try experiments with. So we've had so many attempts to get in via all kinds of backdoors. Also because we use a lot of software aimed at being open. Now, this is a community. Our website should be open and accessible for people to contribute. But everything you keep open can also be abused. So we had to very quickly transfer the old PHP post-nuke Blender.org website to only use Typo 3, which is still unfinished and not perfectly working. It has to be finished in the next year. Another big event was the Google Grants. Google granted 10 of the Blender developers with each $5,000, $4,500 plus $500 for a mentor who was helping the developer to get into the Blender code. And you can already see a lot of results from that in the current software release, and during the next months more projects will be added in the Blender tree. The 8 of the 10 students have completed. Google is extremely happy with the results, how it worked. Much likely next year they will do another round of submissions. And this time everybody be prepared and be ready to do that, because they have an extremely short time span. You have to, in 1 or 2 weeks, you have to fill in all the forms and submissions. The other thing I'm doing right now, this is in the background, it will be open next week, there's a foundation summit. Since I'm doing this Blender Foundation thing, I mean, this is for me the first time too, I'm doing organizational aspects of open source development. So I've contacted people from O'Reilly and GNOME, GIMP, for example. We've started a mailing list for people who are organizing open source projects. This mailing list has grown in the last 6 months immensely. So now suddenly everybody, OpenOffice, Mozilla, Apache, all the open source foundations are member of it. At end of next week, Friday, we will have a one-day conference in Amsterdam as well to talk about this foundation business. It's very important to talk with each other how we do things. How can we efficiently organize open source? And everybody can remember 5 years ago this big internet hype where you could get 10 million euro to have some crazy business. But at this moment, there seems to be another hype coming up. Open source is hip and cool, open source is successful, but how are we going to avoid these big pitfalls we had 5 years ago? This conference as well. Now, the last other activity I'd like to mention is, of course, this was an idea I had last year already when I met with people from the Netherlands Media Art Institute. This is an institute in Amsterdam that invites artists to come over for a period, like 3 months, to work with a couple of technicians on a media project. And I thought this would be a very interesting way to have Blender development supported and have a more organized way of open source development without the need of starting a real company. I mean, for example, Mozilla is a big company. They've got like 100 people working in an office to do this open source development. That's not really the community development. That's not really how Blender is doing it at this moment. And I'm still not sure if we should do that. So the Orange Project is in fact the first experiment of trying to get temporal projects, get really good people together, very focused on not only the software development, but combining it with a content project. So we've managed to get the subsidy monies and funding to have 5 artists from all over the world coming over to Amsterdam, 1 technical director, and they can work for 6 months on an open movie. It will be a 3D animation short, which the first teaser trailer will be published this evening and is shown here as well. The open movie also means that everything the artists are going to make, and already are making, will be published in an open license when we are finished. And a lot of little things will already be published during the process, but in the end, people can get a couple of DVDs with all the blend files, and all the textures, and all the models, and all the scripts, and everything on it. Also, the license to play back the movie, including the high-definition version, is fully free. So any TV station or theater has the right to show the movie. The goal of the project is especially to validate Blender and support open source development. I mean, a lot of people have different opinions about what Blender is, and because Blender can do a lot of different things. For example, we have this game engine in Blender. With Python and Blender, you can configure it into a lot of different ways, like architect uses or for computer-aided design. There's a lot of people who only use it for rendering stills. And there's the animation side of Blender. And this project is especially meant to help further development of the animation aspects of Blender. This has been fallen behind a little bit over the past years, and I think still that animation and animation software is really one of the core features Blender should offer. The last thing what we benefit from it is, of course, publicity. I mean, Blender still has this bad name of being a free tool, only 4 or 5 megabytes. I mean, that can't be anything. And we have such an enormous user community. You also find really fanatic users there who post very ugly messages on CC Talk or whatever websites. So whenever anybody dares to say something negative about Blender, you get big flame wars. And that's a little bit not a good image for professional users. And professional users, what they want to see is just a result. So okay, what can you do with Blender? And not many big studios are using Blender at this moment. So that's why we just think, okay, we make our own little big studio, and we get the best people we can find together and have them make a really, really exciting movie. So what's going on for next year? Of course, Orange just started, so this will continue until March next year. As part of the Orange project, we're going to make a couple of training DVDs. It's very interesting to see people using Blender, especially the power users who do things surprisingly fast and quick. I mean, if you see somebody just sitting behind Blender and pulling some vertices, and suddenly there's a face. I mean, what's going on there? How does it work? You have to record it, and you have to see all the little steps and tricks people are using to do this really good. And training DVDs can also help a lot of people to get into Blender much easier than reading documents. I mean, not only people don't really like to write documents, but there's also people who don't really like to read all of it. They want to see pictures and little movies. Nevertheless, we do need a new guide. We cannot make this enormous book with everything about Blender anymore, so we're going to split it in smaller books. Probably, this is still in development, the next book will be only an upgrade manual describing everything that has changed since the last release, 2.3. The website, this is really urgent. We have to work further on the website. Website services are falling behind the need we have. We need a bigger team to do it or some other way to solve it. We are working on it, but it has to be faster and quicker and more accessible. What I already tried for 2 years, but this year I really tried to get it better and more focused organized. It's what I call the Blender Network. This is also a little bit the theme for this conference. I mean, I would like to help, this is the goal of the Blender Foundation, for each of you to get into business with Blender. And professional users, professional artists, or professional developers, is not a quality mark. It doesn't mean that you're really good, but it means that you can use Blender some way within your job to make money with. That's important. It's important for Blender to have users working with the software and not only using it as a hobby or in their free time. A network, for example, could help people to be in touch with each other. It's important that you know if you need some specific feature, Python script, so who can you contact to get the script quickly developed. It can be support. It can be a network of animation studios or animation part-timers who can be hired for productions. It can be writers and authors. It can be journalists who can write tutorials for magazines, etc. So next year, SIGGRAPH Boston is, of course, an important target. I'm still not sure how much we are going to organize there. I still try to get SIGGRAPH to agree on having an open-source theme park next to the commercial trade show, where software projects who work with open-source computer graphics can present together, much better than have it all shattered around the conference. Of course, the other big target of SIGGRAPH is that we want to have the movie in the electronic theater. That would be the biggest reward we can get. The last challenge is that we have to get organized. I mean, Blender is growing, and it's getting so big, and there's so many people interested in participating and doing things. And still, most of these contacts get to me. Sometimes I'm mailing for like 3-4 hours per day, every day, trying to get people in contact, but that's impossible. I can't do that for much longer. So we have to separate it in a better way. We have to structure the foundation more. We have to find people who are interested to work within the foundation to pick up specific services. That's also what I'm talking about with this foundation summit and other open source projects. So what are we going to see in Blender next year? Of course, the Orange project is defining a lot of my time, and the artists have pinned down their long wish list of what they definitely need to get a movie done in movie quality. For example, material layering, to have multiple layers with filters on top of each other of materials, so we can have many shaders layered as well. Pass rendering and compositing. This is just the hottest topic at this moment in computer graphics as well. Instead of having the software rendering so fast that you have an interactive cycle of modeling and rendering, the complexity of scenes demands that you have to split things in little parts. So people can then design a very complex environment and have separate rendering passes, for example, for the people and one for the big room. And then you have everything with the Z-buffer and alpha masks and maybe even a special shadow pass and specularity and everything rendered in a different file. And in the end, you use a compositor to combine everything. And by saving a lot of data, for example, the normals of the faces, you can even do relighting. It means that you can just say, well, I want to have a little bit more blue light in the back. And because all the render information has been stored, you can get nearly real-time feedback on the results. It also means that we need high-definition color, for example, using EXR files. Another big thing, and that might be after Orange, that I really want to tackle the internal event system for people who don't know really what it would mean. For example, the Blender hotkey map is hard-coded within the source. So it's impossible to assign your own hotkeys. But we also got in big troubles because there is no hotkey left. So if we have new features, we really have to look at the whole keyboard to find any free location of a Ctrl-Alt-Shift combination or something. There is no space anymore, so we have to solve that. But another thing is the event system is based on Silicon Graphics specs from 1991 something. It's very old. It means that an event is just 32 bits. two short numbers of 16 bits storing a event, and that's it. There's no intelligence or nothing in the event that says how it could be handled. But you have to move to what they call event handlers. Handlers can assign themselves to loops, and then you can, of course, integrate Python in a very nice way. So any event can be handled with C code or by Python. It should be possible to have it integrated in a way people don't even know that they are using Python. It also can lead to more Python user interface integration. This is still unknown. We have to design how it's going to work, but there's a lot of need for customizing things. So it could be possible that we are going to redesign the interface in such a way that all the button panels, all the interface elements, actually are little Python scripts. So that's how, for example, in Maya, Mel works, and it has proven to be a very flexible and interesting system. So yes, we do need more developers, and also ways how to get all the developers working together. For example, yesterday I got a mail from some engineer, software architect person, and he used all kinds of complicated tools to analyze the source code. And he said, Tom, did you know that the architecture articles you write, that doesn't really resemble how the source code looks like? I said, yeah, that's a big problem. I mean, we know how we want it, but that's also always different from how you make it. It's also because a lot of people would like to get involved in the source code. We do have a long history, but also people who are learning C and are getting into Blender also should be able to contribute. And not everybody then can make the most beautiful or interesting code. So you have to find the balance between, okay, this is a very cool feature, everybody wants it, but it's very bad code, so what are you doing? I mean, yeah. Not everybody understands that, so sometimes users really think that I'm really bad because I'm removing things from the source code, the features they really love, like the Windows full screen button. I mean, that had a big debate because it was unstable, it was horrible code, and nobody wanted to maintain it. I have to kick it out. I mean, we need good developers who understand how Windows operating systems work and how to get on the low-level libraries coded everything in a good way. So Blender 3, I mean, this is a topic already for 3 years. So are we moving to 3, and how are the versions going? I mean, just moving with one little point up. If you look at the releases since 2.25, 26, 27, I mean, now we do 39. But it's 3 years of development. And if you look at Blender 2.25 and at the current 2.4, this is really an enormous amount of work. So maybe this is almost Blender 3.0, or maybe Blender's next year is 3.0. I think that works good, to do things in these little steps. And if we officially would have said 2 years ago, we are going to make Blender 3.0, and everybody would be confused, what are we going to do? Then we have to rewrite everything, that's far too much work. But if you look back at what happened already in the past years, lots of code parts have been picked up, been rewritten, and brought in better control and put back in the source code. It's a very natural and normal process for the source code to evolve. So we should think over how to present Blender as a 3.0 release, probably for next year's summer. But this is open for discussion, and that's why we have the Blender conference. So last thing, a little bit about the conference. Who is who? I mean, I know everybody likes to come to me when they think the sound is not working or there is something wrong, but I can't do everything. So there are more people here, and I would like to point to you to the persons who are responsible for things. This is Tony. Tony is the technical guy. So any problem you find with internet or with computers, if you do a presentation and you want to connect your laptop, whatever, ask him. He knows about everything, and he knows how to contact the WAC people if there are issues. There you can find Angela. Angela is the boss. So I have to listen to her too for 3 days, but in exchange, I can have a lot of fun and talk to people. But if there's anything related to the schedule, or if you want to know anything that's related to the conference or the speakers who need information, just contact Angela. Downstairs on the desk, you find Anja. Anya has already worked for me for a very long time. She's our bookkeeper and e-shop assistant. She's also taking care of the lunches being made and all kinds of things. If you want to buy things from the shop, you can go downstairs to Anya. We could still use volunteers. If you think you would like to help out, for example, with making sandwiches, if you see empty glasses or stuff, just take it downstairs. If you would like to help out with making lunch, you can contact Angela or Anya. There's also space still in the schedule. For example, tomorrow between 5 and 8, we will have an artist showcase. The Orange artist will show 15-20 minutes artwork, how they did it. But there's also space for other people to show their work. If you would like to present work, contact Angela as well. You can find computers to use here. Downstairs we have the small laptops, which is mostly for internet, but it runs Blender as well. We've got a couple of workstations here. There's also a network hub, so you can connect to it with a cable. Downstairs is only Wi-Fi. There's the bigger systems too. They will run first Blender later on, but you can use that freely to do things with Blender. I would like to make a note that that location has to be a silent location when there's a talk here, that we don't disturb the people presenting. The lunch will be at 12:30, 1 o'clock today, I think. Yeah. But actually, all day, I mean, after the afternoon, there will always be sandwiches and stuff, so you don't have to go all at the same time downstairs to pick up stuff. You can even get some sandwiches at 5 o'clock if you would like to. Drinks is fully free as well. You can just walk downstairs to the fridge and get what you like. I would like to advise not to start drinking beer early. I don't want to have drunk people all day here. So let's agree on that we wait for the day schedule to be over, like at 5:30. When the day program is over, then we can have beers together. Then a note about the badges. I mean, I know it's not very cool to have a badge here. I always see people putting badges here and hide them under the shirt or something, but that's not good. I want to have everybody have their badge very clearly visible. That's for two reasons. One is security, of course. I mean, we need to be able to see in one glance if somebody is here for the Blender conference or not. But this is a safe place. You can put your laptop here or computer, and it won't get stolen, but then we have to be able to see immediately if somebody's walking here who doesn't belong here. But the most important thing is just the social aspect. I mean, I can't remember everybody here, and I don't think all the participants in this conference know immediately who everybody is. But it's important to have it here, because when you start talking to somebody, you can say, "Ah, you are Matthew. Hey, nice to meet you." But that's interesting. It has his nickname on it from IRC. That might help as well to meet people. So please have the badge visible. Last remark, we have guests of De Waag. I mean, De Waag is also an office building. People are working here. Not all the places where you can get into are actually places where you are allowed to be. So you can get freely around here and there. That's the tower room where we can be, and downstairs in the Metselaars Kamer, the Mason room, that's where we can hang out. But further, there's no place for you to do things. Smoking is not allowed in this venue as well. You have to go downstairs, outside, and take a fresh air. Okay, thank you. I have to stop now. It's already late. Next presentation is first here, and the modeling workshop there. Thank you, and have fun.